pray, shall we? Father God, I just thank you so much for the truth from your word that is in this psalm. Lord, grace is given to all who ask. Lord, that's huge. And Lord, sometimes we ourselves don't always remember that. And I pray, Father God, that the truth of those words will just remain in our minds. You are an unchanging God. Your promises are true to us all the time. And Lord, I pray that we never let them go. And so this morning I pray for us all that we're reminded of those truths through the songs and through your message today. But Lord, that it remains with us and close to us so that we never forget how wonderful a God you are. Amen. Amen. We're going to just continue in a sort of prayer time, and I've chosen to listen or sing the words "In This Quiet Moment." And it talks about in this quiet moment, right now, wherever you are, home, here, or Zoom, or YouTube later, I do want you to take this opportunity right now to pray for yourselves. And in this quiet moment that we create, ask God to be with you, remain with you, and in fact, his spirit work in you and even make a better you, as the song says. And this is a personal moment, so take the opportunity to pray that. And then shortly after that, we've sung or listened to these words, you're going to listen to another piece of music, which was written many, many years ago by a lady called Sevilla Martin. You'll recognize it when you hear it. But basically, Sevilla, she used to work with her husband as an he was an evangelist, and she traveled with him and accompanied him on his work and did a lot of musical arrangements. In 1904, so quite a while ago, not just yesterday, she was visiting a friend who was very ill. And often when we visit somebody in a hospital, we do that to be there for them. Often we're there to maybe cheer them up, help them see a positive way, to pray with them. But it was one of those occasions where it was the other way round. Sevilla went to visit her friend, and her friend ministered to her. She told her of the word she'd read in Matthew, of how his eye is on all of the sparrows, and yet not one of them will fall to the ground without the Father's care, and even the very hairs on our heads are numbered. So she was expressing how she didn't feel afraid because God was with her. So even though she was dying, God was with her, and that was a wonderful moment. And so Sevilla carried out from that visit, and her reflections on that visit and how her friend actually ministered to her, wrote a poem. And that poem was then given to, let me just remember his name, Charles Gabriel. And he and they together wrote the words, "His eye is on the sparrow." So you can listen to those words in a matter of prayer. So first of all, it's the song, "In This Quiet Moment." And you're going to take the time to pray for yourselves as you listen to that. And "His eye is on the sparrow."
Thank you.
Amen. And Father God, we just thank you that you are ever present and the truths of your word remain true and unchanging. And Lord, today, for this day, for each and every one of us, I pray that we know this and know it to the full and know to not forget, know so much that we don't forget. Father God, thank you for being an amazing God that cares so much about us intimately. Yet you're a great God that knows the biggest picture that we can't comprehend. But Lord, thank you that we can have this relationship with you. And I pray for everyone's relationship with you, that it just gets better and better. Amen. Amen. So that was my friend from Canada playing the piano in her meeting in Canada. Her name's Karen. And yeah, I think probably because of lockdown, we've talked more to Karen, even though obviously we're not in Canada. But isn't that nice that we can, lockdown's allowed us to sort of get in touch more with people, even though they're a distance away, which is lovely, isn't it? So we're now just going to have a little bit of a catch up, because this week a certain David Crick, can you see him there? I have arranged that we're going to zoom into him, not hurt him, just zoom in. We're going to zoom into him and find out about his week, because something significant happened this week. So can you hear me, David?
Yes, I can. Can you hear me?
Isn't technology awesome? Well, it is right this moment when it works. Yes. How are you, David?
I'm very well, thank you.
It's quite cool, this, isn't it? Chatting away. It's fun. What happened? What was significant this week? Thursday, I think, was the day.
Well, that was the day I technically retired.
Yes.
I use the word technically because the job doesn't stop.
No, I think you're going to be a helper.
Yes. I ceased to be paid for what I was doing. Now I'm going to volunteer.
But I think, Marilyn, how does it feel that David is going to be around you a bit more and not so tied to the office here?
Be honest. Be honest.
In some senses, good.
Yes.
Some senses, not so good.
Okay, we should just stop there.
It'd be very good.
Well, and of course, with David not being so well lately, I think it's a much needed rest that you need. So I do hope you get one, David. And you know, the extra bit of work that you might help with is not so heavy.
So do I.
Yes. And we managed to do a little goodbye, didn't we, on Thursday?
Yes. Yes. You asked me how Thursday was. It was strange because it was a normal day, but it wasn't. That's some kind folks called me out of the office, and we had a socially distant presentation of some gifts, which are very nice. And I have an exhibit to hand.
Oh, that's part of the gift. It's a nice plant.
It is, yes, that's a climbing hydrangea. And for those that are interested, anomaly SSP petiolaris. How about that?
All right, I know just
a climbing hydrangea, and also a very kind gift of a cream tea for two for myself and whoever I'd like to invite. But I presume it's Marilyn.
I hope it's Marilyn. Yes. Yes.
So that was very kind of folks to do that.
Yeah, well, you deserve it. It's just a token, really, of appreciation, David. Yes, and then we said a prayer as well, didn't we? And we prayed for Marilyn. No, I'm just joking. Okay, so, I'm really pleased. And this Friday, we actually interview for somebody to be the new debt advisor, coordinator person, what David was doing. So please continue to pray into that. And so, David, just thank you very much for being you and running that for 4 years, I believe. Am I right? Or is it five? Four? He's muted now. He's nodding. He's saying yes. Okay. So there's other good news as well that's happened this week. I think that's good news for David, more than us. I feel a bit like, oh, there's a gap, and I'm uncomfortable with the gap. But for David, it's good news that he officially has retired. And there's other good news. Do you want to come forward, young man? Yeah, I'll put mine on. You take yours off. How's that? And we can do, this is almost a meter, so we'll distance a bit. Look who I've got with me. There, you're on camera. It's Joseph Drury, everybody. And Joseph has some news this week, haven't you? You can take yours off if you want.
So I don't mind keeping it on.
Oh, all right.
As long as you are, so I thought.
Well, I'm taking mine off. I'm steaming
up.
Oh,
well, I'll take mine off.
Oh, you took yours off. I'm putting mine on. Oh, we're all trying to do this proper. It's a malarkey, isn't it? Can't you wait for the day? Okay, Joseph, come on screen. Tell us what's good about your week.
Well, basically, this on Wednesday, I passed my driving test. Say after about sort of 7 years of it, of like, you know, being a provisional learner at 17, having lessons for four or five months, and then having a mental block and just giving it up for two or three years, and then you know, when the pandemic struck, I thought, well, I can't do anything that I enjoy doing in the week, so it gives me a focus, something to do.
Yes, and you've managed.
And, yeah, and it was my parents really that gave me the kick at the backside to just sort of
well done.
You know, and go for it. But no, I'd recommend. I did a 5-day course in the end, and I would say to anybody, if you know anyone's thinking about driving, who doesn't drive, I think that's the best option, because obviously you get all the driving experience crammed into a week. You know, where I did 4 hours a day from Monday to Friday, and obviously you get tuition in the classroom if you haven't done your theory test. And I was also, so I've passed my driving test on my third go, and same for my theory, I didn't pass that till the third time either, so it's been a slog, but I got there in the end, and anybody can get there, you know, you just put your mind to it and you don't give up, you know.
Well done, dude. We're so pleased. And I guess one thing about it being repeated a few times is you get less nervous, I assume.
Yes,
I guess nervousness is one of the issues you had.
Yeah,
but I guess you got a bit used to it after three times.
Yeah, as I say, it was just the pressure of the exam. I'm terrible in exam situations at school. I know I did like three GCSEs, and the rest I did were BTECs, which were coursework based, because I'm not an academic, so doing practical, you know, BTEC courses helped me. And obviously, I've had a car for 3 years. It's a 16-year-old Ford Fiesta, but it drives well. And I got it off a friend, and it helped having the car and being able to practice every day for the last year with my parents, you know.
And so have you driven to work yourself? Are you independent?
Yeah, I've driven to work.
Yeah.
And then I would have been here on time this morning, but I got lost. I went to Hampton to get, you know, get some hand sanitizer and things.
Yeah.
And then I thought, no, I won't use the sat nav. I'll follow the road signings.
Oh.
And I must have been concentrating elsewhere, or, you know, or listening to words of the CD too much. But I just.
Oh well, you've had a nice view of Peterborough this morning. Shall we say that? There you go.
Yeah,
that's really great, and we really celebrate your achievement with you.
Thank you.
Well done.
Thank you.
Okay. Ooh. Hang on, I've just put my glasses on. Okie dokie. Right. So this morning, before we have our message, which is about believing in transformation, which I hope will just help us focus on exactly what we're saying when we say we believe in transformation. I know that might sound silly, but bear with, it may come. But we're going to sing or listen to a lovely song, Lord, You Know That I Love You. And there's some lovely helpful words in this song that just help us. Thank you. words. Holy Spirit, fill us with your power, make us strong. Wonderful words, and perfect just to lead us into our message this morning. Of which, I've asked Gary if he'll come and help. Just, I get a bit sick of my own voice, and I think I assume you all get sick of hearing the same voices as well. So we thought we'd split it up a bit. You're red, I'm black.
And to be fair,
yes,
we've separated ourselves because we were having too many occasions where you was messing about too much.
Yes, and I've missed him already this morning, and, so I've asked him to join
and
me again.
The general's call for us to go on tour is not happening yet.
No, we don't really want to do the tour, even if he asked us. Because they were all mistakes. We were only fun because they were natural mistakes. But here we go. We're not going to make any now, are we?
No, Lorraine.
No. I have literally, what he means is, see, during last week's meeting, as Gary was speaking, his chair was really wobbly. And I'm going, oh no. And I pictured another meme being made of us because we'd fallen off our chairs. So we've taken the chairs away, and we hope it's a bit better. Although
but this is nice,
nervous.
Isn't it? Look, this is nice.
Yeah, we've given it a little clean and let's spruce up. And you know, it moves really easily. I have to keep checking that the wheels really are not in action. You can change them to go up on the wheels because it moves so easily on the wheels that, like, I would, you know.
If you can't see at home, this is the Lord's Prayer in the cross.
Yeah. And it's clever, it's nice. You just have to be up close to see
it. You'll have to come and see
anyway,
it.
Anyway, shall we get on with our sermon?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Sorry. Oh, my buttons come off my trousers.
Are you kidding? From where?
My trousers.
But where on your trousers?
Just the pocket.
On the pocket. I'm glad it's not the waistband, Gary. Whew. Although there would be.
Here, ain't it? See what I mean? As soon as we're in the same proximity,
oh, man.
2 meters distance.
You want me to do it on my own?
Get on with it.
Okay, now then.
Oh.
You made me giggle.
Molly's shaking her head at you. Anyway.
At me? Not my pants that have come apart. Now then.
Get my pants out of it.
This is serious now. God cleans us up by taking away.
Amen.
Sins from our life and making us a new creature in Christ. True?
Yes.
Sometimes, like with Paul in scriptures in the Bible, Jesus does a big sweep up and there's a dramatic moment of transformation. Yes? However, every day God works on us to make us what we need to be for him in his life. We have many flaws in our lives, if we're honest enough to admit. But God daily helps us to change these flaws and to become the people he desires us to be.
People use the word transformation to talk about the remodeling of a house, such as in the series Grand Designs. They're often talking about transforming the house. And when someone gets this makeover in their house, and there seems to be endless programs
about a makeover transformation.
So the house or person that undergoes this major change ends up looking different on the outside. And it's understandable to think for us that transformation for Christians means that we improve ourselves or our behavior. So we appear more like Christ.
But the biblical meaning of transformation actually has nothing to do with our outward behaviour or our self-improvement. I read not long ago of a man who loved walking his dog. Many of us who have a dog love walking our dog. And when the owner broke his leg, sadly, his dog also began to walk with a limp. He was taken to the vets and the vet could not diagnose it at the time. When the man happened to need to go into a hospital for an op on his leg, his wife walked the dog and noticed nothing was wrong with the dog's walk. It turned out the dog was imitating his owner's walk after breaking his leg. Simply trying to conform to the words that we read in the Bible is a bit like a dog imitating the actions of a human being. What you see is learned behavior, not a genuine expression. That's because the dog doesn't have the life of a human, right?
And God knows that we can't meet the standard of his word on our own. God's way is to give us a divine life-giving gift, and for us to undergo an organic change by his life operating in us by his Holy Spirit. 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 18 says, "But we all with unveiled faces, beholding and reflecting like a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from glory to glory, even as from the Lord's Holy Spirit."
This verse doesn't say that we are being transformed by improving our behaviour. Here, being transformed is connected to our observing the glory of the Lord. When we observe the Lord in our fellowship with him, something wonderful happens. It's like making a cup of tea. Now, one good thing about this, Rostrum, is that, you know, earlier I put boiling water in here to keep it warm. I don't know how warm it is, but I'm just going to make a cup of tea, if you don't mind. Put the tea bag in. The hot water, it's not that steamy, but oh look, you can see it's already making tea. Can you hear that? Making need the toilet.
The sound is not helpful for this middle-aged man.
Okay, now what I wanted to happen is happening. So the water was warm enough. Gary, you can drink it when you're ready, but just let it do its job first. Okay.
I'm infusing.
Just let it do it. It'll naturally infuse. Oh. Let go. When we with unveiled face are beholding and reflecting the glory of our Lord, he infuses us with elements of what he is and what he has done. Therefore, we are being transformed to have his life shape, his life power, with his life essence. And being transformed indicates that we are in a process of transformation. Note that when we behold and observe the Lord, a bit like we're the warmed water, and then more warmed to boiling, it's better, isn't it, when the tea bag, God, infuses. To infuse means to fill, pervade, and soak. So how do we behold the Lord? Well, not long ago, I gave you all an image, God's greenhouse, and on there it gives you many ways that you can behold the Lord. You can be with him, observe him, and know him.
2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 17 says, "The Lord is the Spirit. And when we were saved, the Holy Spirit came to live in our spirit." So we can behold him in our spirit by being with him in prayer and in his word. As we behold the Lord, he soaks, infuses us with all that he is.
Now, you science buffs out there might see that I did a bit of research. Metabolism, you see, is a good picture of this transforming work that God does in us. Physical metabolism consists of two actions: the breaking down and the discharging of old elements, and the building up of new ones. As we behold the Lord, more of Christ is infused into us and spread into our soul, replacing our old natural element. Spontaneously, we begin to live a different way than we did before. This is really important for us to grasp, because we humans do pin spiritual transformation on people's ability to remodel themselves. When we do that, we then take God out of it, and then we make mistakes. Like, we might decide if we think a certain individual, including ourselves, is capable to change or not. And when we see the list of faults in a person and the weight of that sin and see the need for their change, we must have a proper understanding of transformation. God does and is and will transform lives.
A good illustration of this being metabolically transformed is the change a caterpillar goes through during its lifespan. We've used on more than one occasion the story of the very hungry caterpillar. I'm sure you know that. If you don't know that, I wonder which planet you've been living on.
I nearly had ideas of reading it this morning, but I thought maybe not.
It's a great story. Mm-hmm. And a caterpillar from at birth has the life that will transform into a butterfly already present. It doesn't put on a butterfly costume. It doesn't suddenly find butterfly. It already has that latent potential within it. The caterpillar simply eats, and I love this, the caterpillar just eats. Its only job is to feed itself on the things of life in order to release the potential of butterfly. It eats the needed nutrients and grows, and then makes a cocoon where it remains. Little by little, changes take place in its body. Eventually, as we all know, the caterpillar emerges from the cocoon as a beautiful butterfly, and the dramatic change of crawling green worm-like creature into a graceful, beautiful butterfly is a result of this organic process.
At our spiritual birth, we receive the life of God, which will transform us. Now, like the caterpillar, we need to eat. We need to eat spiritual food so we can observe him and grow and develop in the Lord's life. And as we grow, we're gradually changed inside and out.
The Lord wants us to take him in as our real spiritual food. In John 6:35, Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall by no means hunger, and he who believes me shall by no means ever thirst."
In the Gospel of John, we see the Lord is living bread for us to eat, and living water for us to drink. He is the spiritual nourishment that we need to take in every day so we can grow in his life and be transformed.
And mark number 6 of our 10 marks of wonderful church says, believe in transformation. Believe God has the power to transform even the most untransformable. Believe in the power of his word. Believe if we concentrate on his word, then we are being transformed from the inside out, just like the caterpillar in the cocoon.
I believe God can change the hearts of men. It was in the song earlier.
It was in the song. I believe God can change the hearts of men. Even the simplest of sentences sometimes are difficult.
Nerves, we've got camera. It's okay.
Are you nervous?
Yeah, very. Uh-huh. Keep going.
Relax, it's fine. I'm here for you.
Deuteronomy
chapter 30, verse 6. The Lord your God will change your heart and the hearts of all your descendants so that you will love him with all your heart and soul and so you may live, which reflects mark number 1, which is love the Lord your God with your heart, soul and mind. Psalm 33 verse 15, he made their hearts so he understands everything they do. The maker of hearts also knows how to remake hearts.
Amen. It's a mistake for us to perceive transformation is only like the powwow, immediate change, like what Paul had. Paul needed a dramatic change on that Damascus road. That's what he needed. But don't think that all of his transformation happened in that moment. Transformation is a process. It's a transition. Yeah. Some of us are caterpillars. Others of us are hungry and curious caterpillars. Others are courageous caterpillars. Others are hidden cocoons but growing in wisdom. Others are surrendered butterflies. You see what I'm saying? But what does the Bible say about that transition, about being in a process of transformation? Well, this is the verse that you might not pick up on to be with you in these times, but this is what it says about transition to me. In Philippians 4, those famous verses 6 and 8 say, Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. Just in case you have not heard it yet, we do not get to decide who will be transformed or in what ways they should be changed. We need to believe we are all being transformed and God knows best. We all can be transformed, and I encourage us all to remain with God. Being part of a wonderful church means believing in God's transformation today. We're going to play a song that says how God doesn't change, how Jesus doesn't change. He is always there.
Change, you live for love on a grand
Father, we just thank you so much that you're a wonderful God who has the capacity to do many, many amazing things in our lives. We think of the times when we've seen people's lives transformed, and it's been an amazing sight. Lord, we're sorry for times when we expect it to be done quicker, when we expect to see things the way we think we should. Father, let us just trust in you and in your work in our lives. We know that you are transforming us. So long as people are turning to you and knowing you and seeing your glory, Lord, you will do your amazing work in us. And Lord, for that, I am so grateful. I'm also, Heavenly Father, so grateful that you don't miss anybody out. Amen. You are, don't pick your favorites. No. And Lord, you know exactly what you're doing. So right now, today, we say we trust in you. Yeah. We believe in transformation. And Lord, we just pray that we remain part of that, coming closer to you every day. Amen.
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 The tea's looking good.
It is very infused.
Considering it was only tepid water.
It wasn't very warm.
No.
I put it in that cup because I was, well, could you imagine if I'd put a kettle down there and it was boiling and you suddenly, it wouldn't be discreet now, would it? It would look a bit odd.
So thank you. Thank you for that. Thank you for preparing that reminder that God can transform. And do you know, it just struck me while you was praying that it's a journey for us to sometimes believe that God can transform the worst of people.
Yeah.
But for some people, the journey is that believing that God can transform me, you. Yeah. So it's both of those journeys are equally valid and for some equally difficult.
I often think of a lady, you know, when people think it's a big dramatic change. I did know a lady that did. She used to be a complete chain smoker. Her name was Audrey.
Audrey.
And she's great, but proper, one after the other, all day long, for years and years and years. And she said when she trusted in Jesus for the first time and said, I'm going to do this properly. She just stopped. And I mean, if you know what it's like to have an addiction of nicotine, she just stopped. And I found that amazing, you know.
But she continued on her journey of believing that she was good enough. So
yeah.
So her journey didn't stop at that breakthrough moment. Her journey began there. Mm. And she was great.
She was an awesome lady.
Yeah.
Far from perfect.
Well, she still is.
Aren't we all?
She still is.
Yeah. She still is. Yes, she's alive.
She's very much alive. So just a few announcements. Firstly, the most important and biggest one is that read your newsletter, because there's lots to digest in there, loads to celebrate. It strikes me every week at the moment there's great things to celebrate in a church that on the face of it is quite shackled and restricted, actually how alive and brooding we are as a church fellowship in terms of our mission within this community. So whilst you might feel like your normal thing is not happening, actually there's stacks of things that are happening, stacks of things that are on the verge of restarting or starting for the first time. So do be excited and be super excited about being part of this thriving fellowship within this community. So bless you. So whether you're a Zoomer at home this morning, or a roomer here, or you're looking later on YouTube from somewhere else on the planet, just celebrate what God's doing in the city of Peterborough. It's a great thing. Celebrate what God's doing wherever you are, but particularly because this is Peterborough Citadel's best of both worship, so we're allowed to be biased. We thank God and we celebrate what he's doing here. Just need to say, look at these, just come towards me, dear. These beautiful flowers, arranged.
I'm going to get out of the way.
Arranged by Jill Shanks. I can name some of them. This is a gerbera. I know that because it was our wedding flowers. I didn't want them, but Lorraine said gerberas are nice. And I decided I'd dig my heels in at that moment and say, no, I don't want gerberas. I didn't even know what they were. Anyway, roses. and other things. So thank you, Jill. But importantly, as much as Jill's skills and gifts of presenting these are in memory of David. And we thank God for David's life every time we remember him. And Liz, thank you so much for helping us remember David's legacy within this church and David Parker. And we just want to thank God once again for David's influence over this call. And this is a great remember. It's his birthday today. It would have been his birthday. And there's a lot of other people's birthdays. It's a popular day to have a birthday. It's Nathan and Katie's birthday too. Who else's birthday?
Yesterday, another Crake.
Oh, it was Richard Crake's birthday. Crakes, you've really bunched together your birthdays. Really have. It must have been, you must have to save up all year for the month of whatever month we're in now. May. April, then May. I just want to say it's great to see Mike Gibbs on Zoom this morning. Mike's not been that well, actually. And he's been in hospital, but he was so grumpy and irritated the nurses so much that they kicked him out really quickly. So it's brilliant that Mike is on this morning, looking his normal spring-like joyous self, sitting next to Janet. Janet, I'm sorry about that, but he's there. But it's great to see you with us. So we're going to have a close. I think that's the announcement. Have I missed anything? Prayer meeting, Zoom next Sunday. Children's meeting on Wednesday. Look out for an email. We're going to have a final song, and this is I'll Stand for Christ. Now, I think my reading of the government's current legislation is you can actually stand up if you're in the room. You can't move at all, but you can stand up. So if you want to literally do what this song says, I'll stand for Christ, why not do that? I don't think we're going to... Yeah, I'm not a virologist, but I think it's fine. So I think you can stand where you are. You can't sing, but you can look in your eyes, smiling. So we're going to go sing if you're at home, I'll Stand for Christ, or Stand for Christ in the room as we sing this great song. We've got Charlie Green and somebody else from Droitwich Spa. And I feel bad because this young lady, everyone's going to watch this video and say, oh, there's Charlie Green. Who's that? So we should be able to find out who this young lady is. So here we are. We'll stand if you're in the room, or we'll sing with a blom at home.
In the army of Jesus, we take our stand to fight against the forces of sin. To the rescue we go, Satan's power to our throne. And now his and his pardon he gives unto all.